The first reading is taken from John and chapter 6, and reading verses 51 to 58. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Then the Jews began to argue sharply among themselves, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and I in him. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your forefathers ate manna and died, but he who feeds on this bread will live forever."
Insights into Jesus and his ministry. It could be that you're getting a bit fed up with the continual theme of the bread and food and may have wondered what else we could say on this subject week after week. We've had the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000 and Jesus teaching his disciples. We have looked at the ideas of food for life and food for spiritual life. Food for the body and food for the soul. It never surprises me how many people want to tell us what we're all supposed to eat. Do you ever get to that point when you think, just go away and leave me alone? I think in the last few weeks when I was away on holiday and when I came back, my favourite consumption during the course of the day would have been Cornish ice cream, followed by fudge and chocolate. And we end up being what we eat rather than what we are. And it often shows itself in places I rather wish it didn't. We all understand that we are changed by what we put into our bodies. And Jesus too takes us down this road. He does fortunately steer clear of diets, and he concentrates on his body and blood and what that means for us. The other Gospels look at the words of Jesus and interpret them in the Hebrew idiom of "eat my body and drink my blood," as accepting the whole person. When we take communion, it is eating and drinking indicate that we accept Jesus' teaching and life. So we come this week to this section that begins with the last verse from last week. And we have Jesus trying to explain about flesh and the idea of chewing and munching. And he talks very graphically about flesh. In his style, Jesus was very blunt. And in a society that has watched crucifixion, the subject was considered in very bad taste. Even today, we shy away from the reality of Jesus' death, of the cruelty of the cross, and we don't like to consider his flesh that was torn and stretched and tortured for us. The blood that he shed was poured out of his wounds and bled for us. What we prefer is to sanitize it all, keep it clean and pristine. Sadly, though, it was not going to be pristine and clean. It was a death that we don't like to dwell on. But because of his death, in that manner, all the human race has been forgiven. We have been offered a new life, new hope, love and forgiveness. After all, God must love us so much to offer his Son in that way and for him to allow it to happen. Communion, Eucharist, if you want the big word, is a time to remember that event, but not perhaps to dwell on the gory nature of his death. Instead, it's a time to remember him as he commanded, to remember his life, his love, his teaching, but most of all, his acceptance of each one of us, just as we are, warts and all. When we as individuals decide to go into ministry, we are asked a question. We're asked, which ministry do you think you are called to? And what do you think God wants you to do? That's not an easy question. It wasn't an easy question a number of years ago, and it hasn't improved since. Do we want to be the people who are called to give communion, or those who are called to be with those in hospitals and homes? I believed then, and I still believe now, that I was called into the ministry of sacrament and word. But no, doesn't matter how many years of college and training, nothing prepares you for that moment when you take communion for the first time. In fact, actually, it's every time. It's a time we build up to during the course of worship. Some people say to me, communion gets tacked on the end. Well, it doesn't if you're keeping track of where we're going through the service. It's a time we come to prepare ourselves and the bread and wine for God's moment in our service. For me, I prefer it to be quiet and reverential. It's not like handing out the hymn books, a valuable job, but it's different. Nothing, though, prepared me for that time when I realized that as I gave bread and wine to people, I was standing in a space where God comes to every individual. It is their moment of time with God, and I am a mere instrument of his presence. God comes to us. He accepts us just as we are, with all the joys and the sadness of the moment, and he holds, loves and forgives us. It is a beautiful moment of grace. For me, anyway. It is held by me for everyone who comes. If taking communion has become a chore, a routine for you, then when we share together later on this morning, remember that that moment is just for you. It is for you to have communion with God and no one else. And those who wait to come and stand or sit in their seats, wait in silence, holding the moment that is theirs. And the one who stands to allow God to do his work with that person. It is not a time for chat and catching up with a neighbour. We're invited to take bread and wine and remember his body and his blood, broken and spilt for each one of us. And to receive that love with which that comes to us. It's also to share together the love and forgiveness that Jesus brought and use it to bind ourselves and one another with him so that we can prepare ourselves to face a world that needs that love and forgiveness more and more. Our second reading comes from Ephesians chapter 5. And verses 15 to 20. Paul was encouraging the Ephesians to live carefully and to remember what they were there to be. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what the will of God is. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Be careful about how we live. Well, we get up in the morning, don't we? We perhaps have our tea or coffee, whichever is your favourite tipple. And we wonder what the day is going to bring. At least if you don't, I do. Especially as I don't take my diary upstairs, so I perhaps don't remember until a bit later on what's on my list of things to do in the day. But that's not what Paul is telling the Ephesians. He is saying nothing is hidden. That God knows us as we are. And we are called to live in the light, to fulfill our Christian call, and our service is to be done in public. He doesn't express how publicly, but just calling to see a neighbour is public, isn't it? He reminds us that forgiveness of one another is the core of our lives and all that we do. It's easy, isn't it, when somebody irritates you or annoys you, and you want to sort of not take it out on somebody afterwards, but you just want to mutter and moan. Do you ever mutter and moan? I mutter and moan from time to time, frequently, about the dog, but then he can't answer me back, can he? God is at the core of all we do. We have been given gifts that should be used for God in His service. We should not prevent others from serving people, from doing jobs. We should share what we have with one another. And everyone is important. However young or old we might be, we all have something we can do. My mother did not appreciate growing old. I would like to say she did it with grace. I think that would not even be true of her, because she had huge grace and huge love, and she served her God. But she got very crabby when she couldn't go out and do what she wanted to do. And she said to me one day, "It's not right. I have nothing that I can do anymore." She'd lost the sight of her eyes. She was going deaf, and she wasn't very mobile. And I said to her, having listened to a tirade for a little while, I said, "Mum, there is something you can do that is immensely important. And you don't need your eyes or your ears or your feet." "Well, what's that?" she said, very crabby with me. And I said to her, "You can pray." And pray she did. And she prayed day after day after day for people she knew and people she didn't. And she found her life to be good again. We serve others in joy and celebration. We serve others in hope and peace. Positivity is a good thing to remember. It's not about what we can't do. It's about what we can. And God allows us the gifts at different times in our lives to do different things in different ways. I am quite sure that my mum is organising heaven very well. She will have got Dad organised. And she will have sorted out whether the angels were in the right order and in the right dress for the right time. She had an immense faith. We too have a faith. It might not be like anybody else's, but that doesn't matter. What matters is that what we learn and we have from God, we use within ourselves and use for the benefit of others. Even when we are fed up with the pandemic and we're tired of the continual demands on what is expected of us, we can still have joy and celebrate. We can still offer hope and peace to others. And we can bring that joy and peace to those we meet simply by saying hello. Because some days it's pretty rubbish when you have nobody to talk to. So may we remind ourselves of God's gift at communion. in bread and wine, in the body and blood of Christ that we share. And may our lives be a testimony of the power of God's glory, manifested in his light that he has given to each one of us. Amen. We come to our prayers of intercession. There is a response to our prayers. When I say, Lord, hear us, would you respond, Lord, graciously hear us? Let us pray. God, most gracious and most holy, grant us the help of your Spirit as we pray for the church and the world. We pray for the church in every land, for those struggling to come and meet together, for those who rejoice in gloriously large congregations and sing their praises so loudly. Those who are persecuted for their faith and hide it for their own security. For the church in this country, as we try to return to some normality and wish to see people back within our walls, sharing with one another. Lord, may we worship and serve you with reverence and with joy. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Lord, we pray for the people of this world. We remember especially today the people of Haiti, the hundreds who have been killed by the earthquake, and the many missing. The total disruption of their lives and the prospect of not much change in a long while. We pray for the people of Afghanistan, with the Taliban parked on the edge of Kabul this morning. We pray, Lord, for peace, for a coming together of peoples. And we remember the many who have died in this conflict. We remember those who were caught up in the difficulties within Plymouth, the people who were killed, innocent bystanders, their families, their neighbours. And Lord, we do not understand or and comprehend how anyone could do such a thing. We pray, Lord, for your courage and support to be with those who need you at this time. Lord, we pray for the leaders of our world, those who have power in governments, in local authorities. May they work for peace and contentment for their people. And that all may find the things that they need. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. We pray for those who are ill or distressed. And in the silence we name those known to us. We pray for the lonely and the bereaved. For those who are in any need or trouble. Come, Lord, to all, that they may be comforted and sustained. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Father, we remember before you all your servants who have died in the faith of Christ. We pray that we too may lead faithful and godly lives in this world, and finally share with all the saints in everlasting joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As our Saviour taught his disciples, we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And we sing our communion hymn number 590, Jesus, we thus obey.
Thank you.
you would join in with the words in the dark type. We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Let us therefore keep the unity of the Spirit in the bonds of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. The Lord be with you. I'm wondering where we got to. Lord and giver of every good thing, we bring to you bread and wine for our communion, lives and gifts for your kingdom, all for transformation through your grace and love made known in Jesus Christ our Saviour. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We praise you, gracious Father, our Maker and Sustainer. You created the heavens and the earth and formed us in your own image. Though we sinned against you, your love for us was constant, and you sent your Son Jesus Christ to be the Saviour of the world. Sharing our human nature, he was born of Mary and baptized in the Jordan. He proclaimed your kingdom by word and deed and was put to death upon the cross. You raised him from the dead, you exalted him in glory, and through him you have sent your Holy Spirit, calling us to be your people, a community of faith. And so with angels and archangels and all the choirs of heaven, we join in the triumphant hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy God, we praise you that on the night in which he was betrayed, our Saviour Christ took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Remembering therefore his death and resurrection and proclaiming his eternal sacrifice, we offer ourselves to you in praise and thanksgiving as we declare the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Send down your Holy Spirit that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of Christ. Unite us with him forever and bring us with the whole creation to your eternal kingdom. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor, glory and power be yours forever and ever. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. And we say together, we do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in your own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Those who come to me shall not hunger, and those who believe in me will never thirst. Come, let us share together. I'm going to give you an opportunity to choose this morning. If you would like to come and stand at the communion rail, please leave three on each side and no more at a time. If you would like to stay in your seat and have your bread and wine brought to you, if you just stay where you are, I'm hoping one of the stewards will work out who we need to go to afterwards. Does that make sense? Then come. If you would like to come forward, then please do.
Never empty, the plate's always full. come and be filled. Love never ending. You're always welcome at the table of grace. At the table of grace. Cups never empty. Plates always full. And it's never too late.
Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet prepared for all people. Amen. We're going to sing our closing hymn, number 661, Give Me the Faith Which Can Remove and Sink a Mountain to a Plain. Blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace, in the power of the Spirit, to live and work to God's praise and glory. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Get out.